Hi everyone. In this video, we do a recap of the AEW Elevation episode which just got wrapped up this week. And besides the recap, I'll also be sharing some of my thoughts about the show. Let me not waste more time and let me just get started with what all I have to share about Elevation, episode 5. Zack Clayton wrestled and lost to Dark Order's 10. Zack is huge and potentially he does have one of those heel qualities of being someone who can bully others. And he also gives a great power slam. 10 was great as is, and he once again won because of his full Nelson submission move, which till this day reminds me of the Master Lock for some weird reason. We then had another new wrestler called Hayden Backlund, who lost a match to Miro. No brainers there. Who from the very onset of the match looked pissed off and deeply upset and frustrated, probably because of the match that he lost to best friends some time ago. Ty Conti and Hikaru Shida then had a tag team match against Katalina, Perez and Leila Gray. The long term impact of their win in the match is unclear, since the women's tag team division as such don't really have a goal right now. There is no championship to go for. I still don't understand the origin of why and how Ty Conti and Hikaru Shida are in a tag team. Also, why is Hikaru Shida focusing more on tag team matches rather than singles matches, considering that she's the women's champion within AEW? Next up, we had Carlie Bravo and Dean Alexander in a match against TH2, which they lost. As in TH2-1. The match itself was a good example about how people with a good in-ring awareness and technical expertise tend to win against other folks who may be high on aggression, but it makes no sense if you don't have a strategy to follow. TH2's veterancy was also at full show within this match. We then had Dasha Gonzalez interview Thunder Rosa with respect to the comments that Diamante made against her some time ago as to how she can't represent all the Latin women wrestlers within AEW. And essentially Thunder Rosa said that she's open for a challenge and that she looks forward to a match with Diamante, which eventually did happen later in the Elevation. But immediately after this, we saw a match involving Orange Cassidy and John Skyler. And this was once again a match wherein we got to see Orange Cassidy's brand of nonchalant, calm, peaceful, going with the flow type of wrestling. One point to remember is that while it's amazing for all of us to look at the way Orange Cassidy goes about his moves and he could easily reverse one person's move and use it against them, it actually involves effort from not just Orange but also the opposite person. So in this regard, kudos must also be given to people like John Skyler who go along with this and help us get a good fun match to watch. Danny Limelight then had a very interesting match with a new debuting wrestler from Japan called Konosuke Takeshita. I hope I'm not butchering that name. Many things to cover here. This was a fantastic match to watch. Konosuke's charm while he entered the ring and throughout his time within the ring. Konosuke's leg lariat. I didn't even know this move existed. I learned about that today. His impressive size and physique. His agility. How both men got opportunities and had great spots within the match. And how despite Konosuke winning the match, I don't think so Danny Limelight walked away looking like a lesser or a weaker person. Both walked away strong from the match. FTR then had a tag team match which they won against Midas Black and Jay Lyon. I felt that this match didn't really work for anyone. Neither did Midas and Jay, in my opinion, get opportunities to show their strength. And it also didn't do FTR any favors because they're already an established strong team. They are counted as one of the top teams in the world. So they should ideally be getting stronger contenders with whom they can at least have an opportunity to show their skill set. This was a pretty straightforward match with some interruptions from Wardlow and Tully Blanchard on the ringside. We then had another tag team match involving Pac and Rey Fenix against Vary Morales and Andre Montoya. I already knew the result of the match would be in favor of the Death Triangle, and that's what eventually happened. Death Triangle is a team who's consistently improving their reputation and being consistent in the way they win their matches. That is a precise amount of aggression along with strategy and their experience. Also, I feel for Vary Morales because not only does he not get any wins in his singles matches, he also doesn't get any wins in tag team, trios, and quad tag team matches. It's guys like him that essentially help further the reputation of strong individual wrestlers, tag team wrestlers, and factions. It's a thankless job, but it's nevertheless something which gives value to people, fans like us. Dante Martin then had a match against Baron Black, which he won. Dante, in fact, brilliantly got out of a couple of moves of Baron Black, which was amazing to see. He certainly continues to become a stronger singles competitor week after week. Like Barry Morales, I also feel for Baron Black because he's also been getting losses after losses in the singles capacity or as a tag team capacity. And I do wonder what's going to happen for him in the long run. But on the positive side, he's at least getting some focus, some scope in the vlogs that we get from BTE and from Sammy Guevara week after week. So that's something going in his favor. Britt Baker then had a match against another debuting wrestler called Skye Blue, which she won. The match can be as good as it is for a wrestler debuting, though I didn't find anything engaging or interesting in the match as such. In Skye Blue's defense though, you get a very short match in order to prove your skills or to show your skills off to probably the people within AEW, like an elevator pitch of sorts, but the wrestler edition. So it can't be completely her fault. For Dr. Britt Baker, no comments are needed because she does have the attitude, she has a catchy line, D.M.D. And after the lights out, unsanctioned match, everybody knows her. And she's got the skills and she's fun to watch and she can pull off some really mean moves. This just furthers her heel character within the AEW franchisee, and it also helps build momentum for her so that she can eventually challenge Hikaru Shida once again for the AEW women's title. The new faction led by QT Marshall, which is something that I had predicted a couple of weeks ago for the very few people watching this video, called The Factory, had their first proper match, as in Nick Comorato and QT Marshall against newcomers called Andrew Palace and Cody Carter. The entire match was just to showcase the strength of The Factory as a faction, and they won. Nick Comorato looks scary strong. And QT Marshall, the way he executes the DDP cutter, it's always fun to watch. Michael Nakazawa then had a match against Seidel's brother Mike Seidel, which he lost. Although he tried to cheat, Mike Seidel got good opportunities within the match to show his flexibility, his agility. It definitely helps further his stature as a singles competitor within AEW. And Michael Nakazawa, I'm not really clear what purpose is he serving, especially in his new avatar of being someone who's always on the microphone, carrying a laptop, carrying papers, booking appointments. What's the deal with that guy? I can't really connect with that persona which he's investing his effort in. Shayna then had an interesting match, and Shayna is someone who was returning after a good amount of time against Leila. This match was also interesting for me because it sort of began to show how Shayna could be turning heel in the near future. I find it also interesting how Leila Hirsch keeps on winning matches not because of aggression or because of other approaches, but because of being a technical expert. I'm also curious about where Shayna goes next. We're definitely due for an all-female heel faction within AEW. Nothing as such is there right now. That definitely is there, and if Shayna continues to be heelish or a full-blown heel, probably the easier explanation would be that she can go ahead and join such a faction. But I feel she could probably benefit by getting into a feud with possibly Kris Statlander as an alien versus alien, because Statlander is definitely an alien, that's her persona. And Shayna, judging by her in-ring attire, she seems to be a Saiyan. Saiyans as such are an extraterrestrial humanoid race. So this can either be an alien versus alien, because they can't definitely form a group given that Kris is a part of Best Friends faction. So I'm curious where this goes ahead. Brandon Cutler then had a match against Penta from the Dead Triangle. This definitely helped further Penta's storyline ahead because they're trying to establish him as a strong singles competitor who will eventually go behind Kenny Omega for the AEW title. Cutler definitely had an interesting match. He put his best effort possible, but nobody would have thought that he'll win the match, especially against someone like a Penta. He also seemed to have gotten hurt during the match, so I hope he recovers soon. Nothing is that serious with him. Also, when Dead Triangle were celebrating their victory, Penta's victory against Brandon Cutler, no one really came out to support him or help him as such. So that was probably somewhat of an experience which even Hangman had faced in the past, after which he joined the Dark Order. So does that mean Dark Order might be getting a new recruit? Need to see. Diamante then had a fantastic match against Thunder Rosa, which I spoke about a couple of minutes ago. Both looked amazing, with Thunder Rosa definitely being slightly more stronger because she kept on focusing on Diamante's left arm, if I remember correctly. Which is interesting because this is an approach which she doesn't usually take in the matches. So it's good that they're showing that she is not a single cookie cutter build. She's not a one trick pony. Her strategy tends to differ from wrestler to wrestler. So she didn't go behind a particular body part because Diamante was taller than her or stronger or faster or bigger than her. She went for it probably because of Diamante's raw aggression, which tends to come out as part of their La Sicaria faction. Also, this particular manner of winning helps to show the wide skill set that Thunder Rosa has at her beck and call. Before I even saw Joey Janela and Sunny Kiss's match against All Ego, Ethan Page and Scorpio Sky, I knew two things were going to happen. Number one, Joey and Sunny were going to lose, and then number two, probably Joey was going to lose his mind and once again start gripping and panicking and being super anxious as to how, if he keeps on losing, he'll eventually become a pizza delivery boy again. If you remember, that's the kind of slant he had gone on a couple of weeks ago after one of their losses. While the former happened, as in they did lose the match, the latter, as in Joey cribbing, did not happen. I actually felt that if Joey were to crib after the match, it was going to make sense because it would have established that for him, wins and losses are important. So if he didn't crib, he didn't react to the loss. That means if he's not invested in his wins and losses, then why should I be invested as a fan? So I felt like a disconnect over there. As far as Ethan Page and Scorpio Sky are concerned, they look fantastic, their match is fantastic, their new tag team winning streak is beginning to build, and both of them showed great camaraderie within the match, and they're amazing wrestlers as is, individually. I also wonder when they'll clash with the SCU, given that they're bound to go up against SCU one fine day. The final match had Cesar Bononi and Ryan Nemeth accompanied with JD against Best Friends, who were accompanied by Orange Cassidy and Chris Statlander. Trent looked amazing. So watching Best Friends go through the match, win the match, was definitely fun to watch. But additionally, I'm also liking this heel faction that Cesar, Ryan and JD have over here. And I don't usually support heels, but I'm sort of liking their combination because there's something very fancy about them, but at the same time, something grounded about them. And JD is already getting appreciated from a lot of people for having his own different style of wrestling. He's not the fanciest person out there, but he gets the job done. And his blue collar, badass persona, that also works in his favor. Also, I feel Cesar Bononi is better with Ryan Nemeth and JD as opposed to being with Peter Avalon, because and with Best Friends' victory in this match, it puts them once again on the roadmap of AEW tag teams to watch out for. That's it for the Elevation show as such. Like I said, it was a bit long, but I did enjoy. I look forward to seeing episode 6 of Elevation next week. If any one of you all want to geek out over AEW in India, in Mumbai, do comment, I'll be happy to talk. Till the next video gets uploaded, and that'll be soon. Take care, stay safe, and have a nice time ahead. Bye-bye.